I was born in a little town called Hope, Arkansas, 3 months after my father died.
I remember that old two-story house where I lived with my grandparents. They had very limited incomes. It was in 1963 that I went to Washington and met President Kennedy at the Boys Nation program. And I remember just thinking what an incredible country this was, that somebody like me, you know, had no money or anything, would be given the opportunity to meet the president. That's when I decided that I could really do public service because I cared so much about people. I worked my way through law school with part-time jobs, anything I could find. And after I graduated, I really didn't care about making a lot of money. I just wanted to go home and see if I could make a difference. We've worked hard in education and healthcare to create jobs, and we've made real progress. Now it's exhilarating to me to think that as president, I could help to change all our people's lives for the better and bring hope back to the American dream.
They're a new generation of Democrats, Bill Clinton and Al Gore, and they don't think the way the old Democratic Party did. They've called for an end to welfare as we know it, so welfare can be a second chance, not a way of life. They've sent a strong signal to criminals by supporting the death penalty, and they've rejected the old tax and spend politics. Clinton's balanced 12 budgets, and they've proposed a new plan investing in people, detailing $140 billion in spending cuts they'd make right now. Clinton Gore, for people, for a change. The George Bush Promise.
Read my lips. No new taxes.
Then he gave us the second biggest tax increase in American history. Bush increased the gas tax by 56%. Can we afford four more years? Bill Clinton, a different kind of Democrat. As governor, Arkansas has the second lowest tax burden in the country. Balanced 12 budgets. You don't have to read his lips. Read his record. Clinton Gore. For people. For a change.
For so long, government has failed us, and one of its worst failures has been welfare. I have a plan to end welfare as we know it, to break the cycle of welfare dependency. We'll provide education, job training, and child care, but then those who are able must go to work, either in the private sector or in public service. I know it can work. In my state, we've moved 17,000 people from welfare rolls to payrolls. It's time to make welfare what it should be, a second chance, not a way of life.
We've been under trickle-down economics for 12 years. Just keep taxes low on the wealthy and see what happens. Well, I tell you what's happened. Most Americans are working harder for less money. Unemployment's up. Healthcare costs are exploding. We are not doing what it takes to compete and win. I've worked hard on a different plan. Let's give incentives to invest in new jobs. Let's spend more on education and training. Let's provide basic health care to all Americans. Putting our people first. Rebuilding this economy, making us competitive. If we do those things, we'll compete and win, and we'll bring this country back.
George Bush at home in Maine. George Bush boating, back home in Maine. George Bush golfing at his home in Maine. In fact, you can find George Bush doing just about everything at his home in Maine, except paying Maine taxes. For tax purposes, he calls Texas his home. In fact, this Houston hotel has already saved George Bush over $165,000 in Maine taxes. And when George Bush saves $165,000 in taxes, guess who makes up the difference? You do. It's morning in Decaturville, Tennessee. But for 650 people who once worked here, there are no jobs. The Decaturville sportswear factory closed and moved overseas.
We were just family. It was a good place to work.
It just hurts plumb down to the heart.
It didn't have to happen. As 60 Minutes reported, the Bush administration used your tax dollars to lure this sportswear factory to move to El Salvador. Tax incentives, low interest loans.
That sign means nothing, really. Not if the government's going to take it away from you.
Buy made in the USA? How can I buy made in the USA when I'm drawing unemployment?
We're Brasher, 27 years.
In the last 4 years, we've lost tens of thousands of textile jobs, many here in the South. George Bush is using your tax dollars to help make it happen. Clinton Gore, ready to invest in America. Clinton Gore, for people, for a change.
Even with two paychecks coming in, still not a lot left and less all the time.
I think that George Bush has forgotten about a good portion of us.
I find the health care costs are just outrageous.
George Bush has turned his back on the health care needs of the American people.
People of Wisconsin cannot afford another 4 years of Bush.
Definitely is time for a change in America.
Bill Clinton is definitely our hope for the future.
I want you to believe that we can make America work again.
He knows we can do it. He knows we must, because we can't afford four more years of the same. And that's what it's all about. It's time to unite this country for change. No easy or simple solutions, but a real plan to jumpstart our economy. Put people first with education, job training, healthcare we can afford. Together we can get this country moving again. It won't be easy, but let's get to work. Clinton Gore, for people, for a change.
George Bush is running attack ads. He says all these people would have their taxes raised by Bill Clinton. Scary, huh? Misleading, says the Washington Post. And the Wall Street Journal says Clinton has proposed to cut taxes for the sort of people featured in Bush's ad. So why is Bush doing it? Because George Bush has had the worst economic record of any president in 50 years. George Bush is trying to scare you about Bill Clinton. But nothing could be more frightening than four more years.
The world is in transition. We must be a military superpower, an economic superpower, and an export superpower. Here's what I'm fighting for. Open markets for American products, tax relief, opportunities for small business, legal and health reform, job training, and new schools built on competition ready for the 21st century.
In his 12 years as governor, Bill Clinton has doubled his state's debt, doubled government spending, and signed the largest tax increase in his state's history. Yet his state remains the 45th worst in which to work, the 45th worst for children. It has the worst environmental policy, and the FBI says Arkansas had America's biggest increase in the rate of serious crime. And now Bill Clinton wants to do for America what he's done for Arkansas. America can't take that risk.
The presidential candidate on the left stood for military action in the Persian Gulf, while the candidate on the right agreed with those who opposed it. He says he wouldn't rule out term limits, while he says he's personally opposed to term limits. This candidate was called up for military service, while this one claims he wasn't. One of these candidates is Bill Clinton. Unfortunately, so is the other.
There is a simple explanation for why this happened.
The welfare system has got to be reformed. I favor reformed welfare. The victims of the current system are the welfare recipients themselves. And I'm not opposed to welfare, but I'm opposed to the existing system that strips every recipient of his dignity. And I want to restore that dignity by giving him a chance to work, give him a shot at the American dream.
To pay for his increased spending in Arkansas, Bill Clinton raised state taxes. And not just on the rich. He increased the sales tax by 33%, imposed a mobile home tax, increased the beer tax. He assessed a tourism tax, created a cable TV tax, supported a tax on groceries. And now, if elected president, Bill Clinton has promised to increase government spending $220 billion. Guess where he'll get the money?
Bill Clinton says he'll only tax the rich to pay for his campaign promises. But here's what Clinton economics could mean to you. $1,088 more in taxes. $2,072 more in taxes. 100 leading economists say his plan means higher taxes and bigger deficits. $2,072 more in taxes. You can't trust Clinton economics. It's wrong for you. It's wrong for America.
To find out how much more in taxes you could pay, call 1-800-MEGATAX.
Bill Clinton's health plan puts the government in control, and that will ration health care and limit a doctor's ability to save your life. His plan would require $218 billion in Medicare and Medicaid cuts in the next 5 years. His plan could cost 700,000 Americans their jobs. Government-run plans have been tried in Europe. Only there, it's known as socialized medicine. You can't trust Bill Clinton's health plan. It's wrong for you. It's wrong for America.
President Bush was very strong tonight.
George Bush made me feel confident.
Bush won this debate.
Slam dunk by the president.
Yeah, I don't trust Clinton. I didn't like his answers. I didn't like what he said.
I don't trust him.
Arkansas is at the bottom of the list. How can he keep bragging about Arkansas?
I thought Bush did a much better job tonight than he had done any other time.
I think the president was very strong this evening. I'm really proud.
I think President Bush did wonderful. I think this is his best debate. I think he let the American people.
Just 2 hours ago, Allied Air Forces began an attack on military targets.
President Bush said today that he reassured Mr. Yeltsin the United States would stand by democracy.
If revolutionaries and terrorists are armed with nuclear and chemical weapons, it may pose new challenges to the president.
In a world where we're just one unknown dictator away from the next major crisis, who do you most trust to be sitting in this chair?
Well, in a few days, you'll make your choice for President of the United States. And it's a serious choice. The most important democracy asks us to make. There are many times that the President alone must make tough decisions that affect people's lives. He is the Commander-in-Chief. And I want you to think about that. He must have the resolve, the maturity, the moral authority to lead the nation in times of crisis. In the White House, in the Oval Office, you cannot be on both sides of every issue. You must make the call, and you must lead. And that's what the American people expect from their president. Our economic future here at home depends more than ever on competing in a global economy, seizing new opportunities and opening new markets. And that's how we can create more jobs and economic strength. America must have a leader who understands the world, who's prepared to act. Leaders of other nations, people all over the world, judge America by the character of the president. And the president's word must be good. People around the world expect that of the United States. The person you choose to lead America must have certain qualities: decisiveness, honesty, integrity, consistency. All of you know that the presidency is the most serious job in the world, and we simply cannot put America's future at risk with a person who is wrong for the job and with policies that are wrong for America. When you make your choice, choose what's right for America. I need your support, and I ask for your vote.
Our children dream of the world that we promised them as parents, a world of unlimited opportunity. What would they say to us if they knew that by the year 2000 we will have left them with a national debt of $8 trillion? What would they say to us if they knew that we are making them the first generation of Americans with a standard of living below the generation before them? We cannot do this to our children. In this election, we have the opportunity to choose a candidate who is not a career politician, but a proven business leader with the ability to take on the tasks at hand, to balance the budget, to expand the tax base, to give our children back their American dream. The candidate is Ross Perot. The issue is our children. The choice is yours. Perot. On voting your conscience.
If you want to rebuild the job base, let your vote say so. If you want a government that comes from the people instead of at the people, let your vote say so. If you want to reduce our $4 trillion national debt, let your vote say so. Look at the issues. Look at the facts. Look at all three candidates, and then vote your conscience.
Ross Perot for president. It is called trickle-down economics. It assumes lower taxes on the rich create prosperity that trickles down to all the American people. Instead of a sound economic principle, it turned out to be political voodoo. Trickle-down simply didn't trickle. In this election, you can vote for a candidate who has the experience to put the free enterprise system to work for the people, creating jobs, building businesses. A candidate who will not play politics,
that will get down to the business of expanding the tax base, reducing the national debt, putting America back to work. This is no time to waste our votes on politics as usual. It is time for a candidate who will get down to business. It is time for Ross Perot.
Good evening. Tonight we're going to talk about how to solve the problems that we defined that face our country. I think we can come to the conclusion immediately with this quote. History repeats itself. The budget should be balanced. The treasury should be refilled. Public debt should be reduced. The arrogance of public officials should be controlled. These are not new words. Cicero said these words over 2,000 years ago, but certainly they apply to our country today. Anytime we do anything, we try to learn from experience. We learned a lot from the first program from your comments. First, you wanted better charts that you could see the fine print on, and you'll have those tonight. Secondly, we had one news announcer criticize the pointer that I used before. So, since we're dealing with voodoo economics, a great young lady from Louisiana sent me this voodoo stick, and I will use it as my pointer tonight. And certainly it's appropriate because, as you and I know, we are in deep voodoo. Well, let's get right to work. Let's sort of do a quick summary of what we discussed before in terms of where we are, then we'll go to the solution. We're $4.1 trillion in debt. That's a staggering burden to pass to our children. It's unconscionable. Just this year, we ran up $341 billion in new debt, and as we discussed the other night, that's our legislators and our president trying to buy our vote this year with what used to be our money. We're not that dumb. Now, where does the money come from? It comes from all these places, and we get $1.1 trillion coming in the door. The two major sources are individual income tax and Social Security and Medicare. Corporate income tax is the third. The others are fairly small. How much money do we spend? We got $1.1 trillion coming in, but we're spending $1.5 trillion. Most of that goes to Social Security, Medicare, and other entitlements. Next to that is national defense, a little over $300 billion. Next to that is interest on the debt. That's unusually low this year because the interest rates are so low, but don't count on that continuing. Every time the interest rates go up 1%, the 70% of the national debt that's 5 years or less goes up $28 billion. That's the impact. What is the net effect of the way our country's been run? What used to be a dollar in 1950 is now 18 cents. No wonder both parents are working, some of them two jobs, just to make ends meet. Running the value of the dollar down is really hurting the people in our country. Now let's look at the net effect on all of us. From 77 to 92, the poorest got poorer, the second poorest fifth. This is 20% of the population, still lost money. The middle fifth, the three-fifths up, still lost money. When you get to the four-fifths, it's break-even. The richest fifth is the only place it went up. Now go to the top 5% and the top 1%. Top 5% improved their incomes by 60%. The top 1% by 138%. Trickle-down economics didn't trickle, and this isn't fair. All right, what about our average hourly wage at a time when we need to have everybody at work and making more money so that we can pay our bills? Just follow it here. It's 60s, 70s, 80s, 90, it's dropping. Shouldn't surprise you, supply and demand, we've got people out of work. Well, just to show you how fouled up the system is, in the middle of all this, what's happening to our corporate executive salaries compared to those of our industrial competitors who are beating us in head-to-head competition? Here's the ratio between worker compensation and executive compensation in Japan. Here's the ratio in Europe, and here is the ratio in the United States. Trickle-down economics didn't trickle at all, folks. It all stopped right here. That's not good for the companies. That's not good for the stockholders. That's not good for the country, and that leaves us vulnerable. These guys want to make this kind of money. They ought to be TV anchormen, basketball players, or rock stars. But running a company, look, these fellows have their heads straight here. They're getting appropriate income, but not rock star income. Let's look at our international competitors. Now, you don't have to like the fact that we live in a tiny world, but I'm telling you, we're stuck with it. Somebody wins, somebody loses. Here we are. Look at how they are growing. Here's our growth. Here's Japan's growth. Here are the newly industrialized Asian countries that at one time you and I thought just raised rice. They're not raising rice anymore, folks. They've got what used to be the high-paying jobs here over there. This chart makes it as clear as I can to you in terms of who is going to own tomorrow. Think of Taiwan, tiny little island. There it is, just in a little piece of Texas. They're going to spend $600 billion on public investment programs. Our great country is going to spend $150 billion, one-fourth that much. We have a population of 248 million. Taiwan has 20 million. In fact, we're over about 12 times their population, and we're spending a fourth as much preparing for the future. All right, let's go from there to Japan. Here is Japan. Japan is about the size of Montana, if you pack it all together. It's much smaller than it appears on the map. Has a population half our size, but Japan is spending $80 billion right now on building for the future, short term. Now let's go to Germany. Keep your eye on Germany. I told you that, you know, they're paying a good price for money. Germany is right here in purple. Germany has 78 million people, but Germany will spend $1 trillion over the next 10 years rebuilding East Germany. We'd better get busy and start rebuilding our great country and not just wandering around saying, well, everything will work out if we don't do anything. Does that ever happen in your life? Say, maybe the problem will go away in my life. If I ever take that attitude, the problem just grows and grows and grows. If you want to have it go away, you make it go away. Okay, here's the end result of letting our country decay like this. The 18 to 24-year-old men in this country back in 1980, 18% of them made less than $12,000 a year. In 1990, it's up to 40%. With the women, in 1980, 29% made less than $12,000 a year. Today, 48% make less than $12,000 a year. And it is voodoo economics. And maybe now's the time for me to wave the voodoo stick and get rid of the hex. But it'll take a lot more than that. It'll take millions of you showing up on November the 3rd to get rid of this hex. Keep in mind, the value of the dollar is going down. The number of people making less than $12,000 is going up. I don't want to bore you with this statement, but trickle down didn't trickle. It just didn't work. We have 19th century capitalism in this country. Our successful international competitors are practicing modern-day capitalism. We need to practice 21st century capitalism. We need an intelligent, supportive relationship between government and business. We need long-term thinking. We need to target the industries of the future and make sure they are here and the words made in the USA are written across them. We need to have the most rapidly growing small business society in the world because we can create more jobs more quickly there. All of this can be done. But just look at that, and I think you'll conclude the way we're going is the wrong way. Here are the solutions. We're going to start with balancing the budget. We've got to cut general spending by $315 billion, business tax increases of $49 billion, other tax increases of $293 billion, entitlement reform will bring us $268 billion, spending increases to help build our country an additional $109 billion, tax decreases $62 billion. It nets out savings of $754 billion. We got to balance the budget just like you have to balance your budget. Congressional Budget Office projection out through 98 is here. Our plan takes us down to here. That's a $754 billion deficit reduction. Do we have to do it? Of course we do. We're going to have a 10% cut in discretionary programs. We'll have a 5% cut in specific programs. These discretionary programs include such things as science grants, farm supports, government operations, et cetera, et cetera. Down here, we'll have a $22 billion cut in business subsidies, and we will have, over this period of time, $145 billion in interest savings just because we stopped spending so much extra money. Tax decreases, it's not all bad news. We will have a $27 billion decrease in taxes to get an investment tax credit, and that money will be spent to build new factories, buy plant and equipment, and create jobs. That money's spent right on the bullseye. Doesn't go in somebody's pocket to buy a yacht. Right over here, we're going to have a decrease here, and it's a tax credit to stimulate research and development. We call it now research and experimentation. You and I used to call it R&D. But this is to target the industries of the future and make sure that we lead and dominate in those industries. We're going to spend $10 billion in tax credits on worker training to train our people for the jobs of tomorrow. Now then, we've got to get money from institutions, from individuals, from every place there is money, invested in the treasuries of companies. Now hold that thought. Not shooting dice on Wall Street, invested in the treasuries of companies so that those companies have the money to create jobs. We will create more jobs more quickly by putting money into little companies, startup businesses, small businesses than any other way, but that is high-risk money. The investor may lose it. We've got to give the investor an incentive to put it there as opposed to buying government bonds or putting it in a bank, drawing interest in a savings account that's federally guaranteed. Believe me, this comes back again and again and again and again, and if anybody has any hesitation about it, we'll have a 30-minute program on this one because we're going to put it in the Treasury. The money will be used to build the company, to create jobs, and the tiny little money that goes into that Treasury and the tiny little bit of taxes that we don't get will be lost compared to the thousands of people that company may eventually employ, the payroll taxes they'll pay, the income taxes that company will pay. It will be a giant financial pump for our country. Business tax increase. We're going to improve the tax collection from foreign companies. That'll get us $21 billion. We'll reduce the business entertainment deduction. You know, kind of almost charge off anything against your income tax on entertainment now. We'll save $16 billion now. Have increase in user's fee of $12 billion. That'll bring us in $49 billion. Other tax increases. Here's one you don't like. Raise the gasoline tax. That brings us $158 billion, which we'll use to rebuild our country. Every other industrialized country has a much higher tax than we're proposing. It's 10 cents additional per year for 5 years. So it's 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. It just adds up over time to a maximum of 50 cents after 5 years. The other two candidates like to tell you it's a 50-cent tax. No, it goes on 10 cents a year. And I'll tell you more in a minute about why we have to do it. We'll have a tax increase on tobacco. We'll have an increase on income tax rates for the top 4% of the population. And we'll reduce tax exemptions for the rich. For example, we'll put a ceiling of $250,000 on mortgages that you can deduct. There will be no deduction on mortgages on second homes. Let's go back to gasoline for a minute. Here's what our industrial competitors are doing. Italy collects $3.57 in taxes for every gallon of gasoline. France, $3.12. Japan, $2.25. United Kingdom, $2.09. Germany, $1.99. And the United States collects 35 cents. We have got to collect more taxes in this country, and this is one fair place to get it if we spend all of that money on building for the future and don't squander it on some new pork barrel program in Congress. This money will be dedicated for specific purposes. This is going to require sacrifice by all of us. It will pay huge dividends for us, our children, and our grandchildren. Now, I will be delighted if someone can come up with a better idea. If you don't like this, we've got to have a better idea. But this one right here, this gasoline tax, let's look at what it raises, $158 billion. Come up with something else that's more painless. It'll give us that. We'll drop it in a minute. Go to that. Entitlement reform. Okay, we're going to have to repeal the salary cap of $130,000 on Medicare. You stop paying after $130,000 of income, you'll have to keep it up under this new program. Medicare premiums were initially designed to pay half the cost of Medicare Part B. Now it's down to 25%. We're going to raise it up to 35%. That'll give us $38 billion. Still a bargain for the people who use it. Healthcare cost containment, we can save $141 billion. You say, how sure am I? Dead sure, and I'll show you in a minute. Here, we will reduce COLAs for federal employees, and here we will tax the top 18% only of Social Security recipients on 85% of their income instead of 50% of their benefits. Now, this gets translated by the other two candidates as we're going to tax Social Security. Or last night, the president said we're going to cut it. No. All we're going to do, instead of taxing it at 50%, we're going to tax up to 85% and of the wealthiest. That's just the top 18%. Again, if you don't like that one, give me a better idea that will raise $30 billion. Now, why am I so confident that we can reduce health care spending by a dramatic amount? We're going to cut it $141 billion. All right, here's why I think so. Look at what the rest of the world spends on health care. 6% of gross national product here. Germany, 8%. Japan, 6.5%. We spend 12% and have an ineffective system. We're spending more than enough to have the world's finest health care. We rank behind 15 other nations in life expectancy and behind 22 other nations in infant mortality. We've bought a front row box seat, air conditioned, and we didn't get to see the show. Just by cleaning this up, there's no question we can do it. We can save money, have world-class health care. All else fails, just copy the country in the other part of the world that have better health care than we do at a lower cost. Spending increases. We're going to spend $46 billion extra on research and development to build for the future. We're going to spend $40 billion on infrastructure. We're going to spend $12 billion extra on education and $11 billion extra on aid to cities. That's $109 billion. All of that will stimulate jobs. It's work that has to be done. Now, I have two charts here. They're very detailed. But it takes everything I've said on these charts that are easy to read and shows you in detail how we come down to the fact that we save $750 billion by the end of this cycle. So if anybody wants the detail, it's right here. It will take an hour to go through every number here, but it all adds up. Now, you remember the Wall Street Journal asked the President and Governor Clinton after they looked at their economic plan and said, can't either one of you folks add? This one does add up. It is real. Could it be improved? Possibly so. Are we flexible to change it and improve it? Absolutely. A better idea is all it takes. What is the litmus test that it must go through? Is it fair? Is this the best plan for the American people, right? Let's assume you put this in and 6 months later somebody has a better idea. We can change it. But the thing we can't do is just sit here playing Lawrence Welk music, wonderful, 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 doing nothing. We've got to start moving. Well, here's the result. Over a six-year period, we'll be down to here. We'll have a surplus in our budget. Why didn't we move more aggressively? We didn't want to disrupt the economy. Where will Governor Clinton be? Right up here. Where will President Bush be? Right up here. Just drifting along, if you will. That assumes everything goes well. Everything that I've been able to learn from studying this problem indicates to me that we need to move to do this. Then, of course, the critics during the campaign are saying, gee, if you go too hard and too fast, you might cause a more severe recession. Well, as I have pledged to use the terms of Vietnam, we will not destroy the village in an effort to save it. If common sense and the interest of the American people dictate slowing down, we'll slow down. Just use your head. But the thing you can't do is do nothing. This would be comparable to knowing you had gangrene in your toe and doing nothing and then wondering why you had to lose your whole leg. Now, we have a $4 trillion debt. Let's look at this map here. Look at the purple, and let me tell you what, if we had the $4 trillion still in the bank, we could do with it. Right now, it's gone. We don't have much to show for it. Worst public school systems in the industrialized world, most violent crime-ridden society, most drug-laden society, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Cities in decay, but that, we know that. Let's clean it up. But if we had $4 trillion, here's what you could do with it. And everything that's purple here, we could buy a $100,000 home for every family in every one of those states. We could put a $10,000 car in the garages of each of these houses. Then we could build 1,000 $10 million libraries for 1,000 cities in these states. We could build 2,000 schools in these states costing $10 million each and have enough left over to put into a savings account and from the interest alone in that savings account pay 40,000 nurses and 40,000 teachers an annual salary of $32,760. And finally, we'd still have enough from the interest income alone to give a $5,000 a year bonus to every family in those states. That's what $4 trillion would buy. We just can't keep throwing money out the window. And this is the year when you have a voice, because you have organized to have a voice this year, and your votes determine who gets into office. Make sure that whoever you vote for in the House, the Senate, and for president is absolutely committed and will handle this problem for you. We've got to reorganize our government to win the economic war. We've got to get ourselves organized for the 21st century. Step one, we've got to slash the White House cabinet and congressional staffs. Staffs don't get much done. All the action is in the field. But for example, in 1960, Congress had 6,700 staff members. Today they have 30,000. The White House had 375 in 1960, and today has 1,850. All they do is clutter up communications between the people and the leaders. We've got to change the whole organization in Washington so that people come to Washington to serve us and not to cash in. We absolutely must stop deficit spending. We've got to replace Graham Rudman with a bill that will really eliminate the tricks, the loopholes, and the improper accounting procedures. We've got to give the president line item veto to eliminate pork barrel and waste. We must eliminate PACs, political action committees. We've got to make our elected officials responsive to the people and not to the special interests. That's job one. We've got to eliminate all possibilities of special interests giving large sums of money to candidates, and we must leave no loopholes. We must limit political contributions to $1,000 and no other way. Today we hold elections on Tuesday. It's hard for working people to vote. They have to go early in the morning or late in the afternoon. Let's change it and hold elections on both Saturday and Sunday. Make it easier for working people to vote. We've got to require all members of Congress and the president to turn in excess political funds from prior campaigns to the U.S. Treasury immediately after a campaign. No grandfather exemptions, no exceptions. We must make adequate television time available in equal amounts to competing candidates. We must eliminate the need to raise millions for campaigns. This corrupts our process. As a matter of principle, we must get rid of all the freebies in Congress and the White House, such as free haircuts, free gymnasiums, free prescription drugs, free ambulance service, and the list goes on forever. These people are our servants. We don't have those things. Why should they? We've got to give the voters the exclusive right to grant Congress, federal employees, and the president a pay raise. That'll keep their heads clear on who they work for. Congress has given itself a retirement plan that's worth 2 to 3 times what you and I get. We need to bring it back in line with ours. Makes no sense for the people who work for you to have a better retirement plan than you have. You wouldn't let that happen in your business. 93 members of Congress under the existing pension plan have retirements greater than $2 million. Let's just make it competitive with our pension plans. Congress absolutely must stop exempting itself from laws it imposes on us, such as the Disability Act, the Equal Opportunity Act, the Occupational Safety Act, Fair Labor Standards Act, and believe it or not, sexual harassment. Only in America would they pass laws impacting us and exclude themselves. It's hard to believe, but we've got 1,200 federal airplanes worth $2 billion that are used to fly our servants around like royalty. Get rid of them. Let them get on a commercial airline. Have the same experience we have. They work for us. We must restructure our system so that the citizens who come to Washington to serve us cannot cash in as foreign lobbyists. They must stop cashing in on public service. Former federal officials, elected, appointed, or career civil service should never be able to serve for lobbyists for domestic interests for 5 years after they leave office. Never should they be allowed to lobby for foreign countries, companies, or individuals. We should impose criminal penalties for violators. We must pass a law stating that former presidents, vice presidents, cabinet officers, CIA directors, the Federal Reserve chairman, Senate majority leaders, and speakers of the House can never lobby for foreign countries, domestic interests, accept gratuities or fees of any kind, or cash in on their service. Our current tax system is like an old inner tube that is covered with patches. We must replace it with a new, fair, simple tax system. Above all, the new system must be fair. It must also raise the necessary revenues. It should be paperless for most Americans. You can't put another patch on the old system and make it work. First, remember Cicero's words. The budget should be balanced. The treasury should be refilled. Public debt should be reduced. The arrogance of public officials should be controlled. That was true 2,000 years ago. History did repeat itself. Now that we have taken a look at some solutions, where do we go from here? If we will all make the sacrifices that I have suggested, if we will all do our fair share, what can we expect? What can our great country be? Let's look past the moment and take a quick snapshot of the future. If we take the steps I've outlined here today, we can again be a country with its spirit restored, its people back to work, and its government back in order. We can be a country where exporting cars is the rule and importing cars is the exception. I want to be around here when that happens. We can be a purposeful and thriving country, building bridges instead of building debt. We can be a country whose people are working hard at their jobs instead of working hard just to find jobs. We can be a country whose children proudly wear their school colors instead of wearing gang colors. We can be a country whose families save some of what they earn rather than spend more than they can afford. We can be a country with health care that is cost efficient and effective rather than expensive and mismanaged. We can be a country leading the way instead of a country falling behind. We can be a country where, once again, the diversity of our people is our greatest strength instead of division being our greatest weakness. We can be all of these things tomorrow if we will make the tough choices today. Passing the American dream to our children is vitally important to every single one of us. When I was a young man, it took less than two generations to double the standard of living in our country. Today, because of the way our country has been mismanaged, it will take 12 generations to double the standard of living of our children. Can this be fixed? Of course it can. Will it be easy? No. The sooner we start, the sooner we'll finish. But believe me, it will be a whole lot easier than a lot of the things the people did for this great country who came before us. I'll take this challenge anytime to going west in a covered wagon. I'll take this challenge anytime over the challenge the people had who fought the revolution and gave us our freedom. They had their lives on the line. This is just hard work. If we will do it, if we will team up, if we will make our diversity a strength instead of a weakness, if we will focus on a goal, and if we won't quit until the battle is won, we can pass on the American dream to our children, because we can do anything in this great country. That is the American dream. We can be anything we want to be. Now, it's going to be tough, but in the thick of it, think of all the difficult things you've done in the past in your life that you totally committed yourself to. I'll bet in retrospect, these are some of your happiest memories. These are the things you sit around at night and talk about. Think how good we will all feel when we have these problems solved. Together, we can do it. Together, we can do anything. Thank you very much. You know, every time Governor Clinton brought up anything in the debates about how you fix a problem that faces a nation, he told us how he fixed it in Arkansas. And as I listened to all of these examples of how problems would be solved for our country, I decided, well, this must really be interesting, and I should study Arkansas because I could probably learn a great deal myself about how to face, deal with, and solve these problems. Here is what I learned. It's fascinating. Now, before I start, I have to use my voodoo stick again, and it's not completely inappropriate because the first time as a boy I ever went to Arkansas, we went to the alligator farm. And this is a simulated alligator claw on a voodoo stick. So it reminds me of my first trip to Arkansas, where one of the things you could go see, this was before Disneyland, you could go see the alligators. Now, the great young lady, Ashley, that gave this to me just had a baby. She's fine, the baby's fine. Ashley, congratulations, and God bless you both. I grew up in Texarkana, Texas, 5 blocks from the Arkansas border. I know from my hitchhiking trips through Arkansas as a child, it's a beautiful state. But let's put in perspective just how big Arkansas is. This little red square here is Arkansas in the United States. The population of Arkansas is 2.4 million people, and that turns out to be less than the population of Dallas and Fort Worth, the Metroplex combined, the population of 2.7. Much smaller than Los Angeles with 3.5 million, or Chicago with 2.8 million, or New York with 7.3 million. So basically, Arkansas is a relatively small population state and a relatively small state in terms of its geographic area. Its annual budget is a little over $4 billion. Compared to the U.S. budget of $1.43 trillion, this little black sliver here is Arkansas, put in perspective. So this is what I referred to in the last debate as the corner grocery store, and this is a giant industrial corporation here. Where would Arkansas stand in the Forbes 500 list if it were a business? Would be 248th, ranks behind Toys R Us, Quaker Oats, and Chiquita Brands. So it, as corporations go, it's not a very big corporation. So you might say the governor's running a medium-sized business. And then the next question is, how well is this business being run? Let's come down to brass tacks now. On the economy, they rank last among the 50 states in median family income. Now, there's no place to go but up. That's the good news. On economy, Arkansas ranks last, it's 50th among the 50th states, in the hourly wages for manufacturing workers. Not much manufacturing work in Arkansas. Manufacturing wages are the high-paying wages, the jobs of the future. In terms of disposable personal income, the people in Arkansas are poor. They're 48th out of the 50 states after 12 years of Governor Clinton's leadership and all these new programs he's put in Arkansas that he's told us about on television. In terms of people living above the poverty level, 46 states have more people living above the poverty level than Arkansas. It's three from the bottom. One of the poorest states in the United States after 12 years of Governor Clinton's leadership. Per capita income of its people ranks 47th, whereas 46 other states, people make more money than the people in Arkansas after 12 years of Governor Clinton's leadership. Tax fairness. Say, well, we don't have much money in Arkansas, but are the taxes fair? It's ranked behind 43 other states in terms of the equity and fairness of its tax system. And here's a man that plans to radically change our tax system in our country. We talked a great deal about the governor's programs for children, his wife's programs for children, their interest in children, and there's no question in my mind that their interest is genuine. But after 12 years, let's look at the results. In terms of child death rates in Arkansas, 49 states have a better record. There's only one state worse. Violent teenage deaths. 47th out of the 50 states, only three states have a worse record of teenage death than Arkansas. Babies born underweight. They rank behind 44 other states, and only five states are worse. Single teenage births. Again, they rank behind 44 other states, and only five states have a worse record. Well, what about two-parent families as opposed to single-parent families? They rank behind 40 other states. So anything you look at concerning children in Arkansas, in this little state, they rank at the bottom or near the bottom of our country. You say, Ross, this doesn't square with these big percentage increases that the governor talks about. It's pretty simple. If your net worth is a penny and you get another penny, you have doubled your net worth. Whereas when you're at the bottom and you make a tiny little bit of improvement, you can show a significant percentage increase. The real test is where do you rank among the other states? And as you can see, Arkansas, after 12 years of Governor Clinton, is still at the bottom or very near the bottom. They talk a lot about the environment. Gore's written a book on the environment. They're going to be very strong on the environment. Well, let's look at results after 12 years. Government action taken to protect the environment in Arkansas, last place among the 50 states. Overall environment quality, they rank 48th out of the 50 states. The percent of clean rivers and streams, you'd think in a rural state that would be very high, but they rank behind 40 other states. Per capita ozone depleting emissions, they rank behind 40 states. Talk is cheap, folks. Action is dear. Arkansas is at the bottom. Well, instead of writing books and talking, maybe for 12 years they should have gone to work on this rural state with a small population where you could just kind of literally grab the lever and fix it, and fix the environment if they intended to. Believe me, the mayor of New York City would love to be able to get his arms around the environmental problems in that city as simply as you could in the state of Arkansas. And all of these programs that were miracles in Arkansas that then get articulated, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, produce this for the people in Arkansas. What you need to ask yourself tonight is, if you put this kind of thinking to work in Washington across our great country with its huge population and its diverse population, what are the odds we would have an improvement, or would it be regressive? What are the odds that a person who's been unable to make more dramatic change than this in 12 years in a tiny rural state would be able to face and solve the problems of our great nation? It's your decision. You think about it. Well, I'll talk about education. College education rates in Arkansas, bottom of the 50 states. High school graduation rates in Arkansas, behind 47 other states, only two states below Arkansas. High school graduates. Now, our future and our children's future depends on their education, and when you're 50th and 48th here, and that's the best you've been able to do in a little state where you can literally just sort of grab it by the ears and fix it, what chance would a person with this performance record have of facing and solving the problems of our great country? Per capita education spending, only one state spends less than Arkansas, and here you see the result down here. Teachers' pay, only four states spend less than Arkansas, and the results are shown here. I guess after I finished studying Arkansas, I was confused, and I couldn't understand how Arkansas could be the role model that we would use to reindustrialize America. And then I started studying the industries in Arkansas, and I'll sum it up right here. The governor talks about all these dramatic improvements in employment and jobs and what have you that he's created in Arkansas. Let's take a quick look at it. One out of five jobs in the last 12 years created in Arkansas has been created in the poultry business. Now, this is not an industry of tomorrow. This is honest work. It is hard work. The people that do it are world-class people. But if we decide to take this level of business-creating capability nationwide, we'll all be plucking chickens for a living. And certainly, this does not give us the job base that we want for ourselves and for our children. Now, what does a person in these chicken factories make? About $7 an hour. That's it. So I guess you could sum it up, you know, the chickens keep on clucking and the people keep on plucking after 12 years of Governor Clinton's leadership. Without questioning his commitment or his ability, you have to decide when you go to the polls, is this man qualified through background and experience to face and solve the incredibly complex problems that our nation must deal with? It's your choice. Here is where Arkansas is today. It's called the land of opportunity. I had it on all the license plates as I grew up, the land of opportunity. It can be the land of opportunity. But as you can see from these charts today, or tonight, Arkansas has not yet realized its potential and its opportunity. Now let's look at the real world. Our children's futures are not in the poultry industry. They're not in the worst education system in the 50 states, and on and on and on and on. The industries of the future are right here. Microelectronics, biotech, telecommunications, civilian aviation, computers, software, and robotics. Is there anything in the governor's background or experience to develop overall comprehensive plans to bring the industries of the future to our great country when the best he could do was expand the chicken business in Arkansas? Now, this is your decision, but I wanted you to have a few facts because I'm sure that you are exactly like I am. You listen to all these wonderful programs in Arkansas. You hear the 1-2-3-4-5 solution for our nation. You say, gee, this is terrific. Let's go do it. But then if you go down and check what has been done in 12 years, what you find is a situation that will not solve our country's problems. Kind of like Will Rogers, about all I know is what I read in the newspapers. And here's some interesting comments from Governor Clinton's hometown newspaper. They say that Governor Clinton is leaving the state's Department of Human Services in disarray. He's leaving the medical payments slashed and its programs uncertain. They say that Governor Clinton had to be sued to do anything meaningful about the scandalous disregard of abused and neglected children in the state's care. They say that Governor Clinton's attitude toward releasing prisoners has been equally irresponsible, and that constitutional reform has languished on Governor Clinton's watch. His own newspaper says Governor Clinton's environmental policies add up to little more than delay and neglect. They say that Governor Clinton may be running for president on a soak-the-rich appeal, but that his tax policies in Arkansas have been to hand out exemptions to large corporations and to soak the middle class. I guess I better get my voodoo stick out here again. They say that the state's tax structure is more regressive than ever after a decade of Clintonomics. They admit that Governor Clinton is a great campaigner. They say Bill Clinton has proved to be a very mediocre administrator of the state of Arkansas. They ask, in his hometown newspaper, are there any steadfast principles besides winning the next election that Bill Clinton would never compromise to win popularity? They say that Governor Clinton has mastered the art of equivocation and that there is something almost inhuman in his smoother responses that send a shiver up the spine. It is not the compromises he has made that trouble so much as the unavoidable suspicion that Governor Clinton has no great principles to compromise. His hometown newspaper goes on to say, how can we recommend him to America as a leader? Now let's take a look at President Bush's record in managing our country's economic affairs. I'm going to have to use my voodoo stick that Ashley gave me, because you know, back in the 1980, when he was running against President Reagan for president, he declared trickle-down economics is voodoo economics. Well, we can look at a 12-year record of it now. They continue to practice it. It's created a $4.1 trillion debt. We had a $1 trillion debt in 1980 when we started this practice. And again, I'll sum it up. Trickle-down economics didn't trickle. This is a huge burden for us to bear. We can't pass it on to our children. Now, if you understood managing money, you'd never let this happen. 70% of our $4 trillion national debt is due and payable in 5 years, and they do that to keep the interest rates low. But every business person listening to me tonight knows that you don't finance long-term projects with short-term money. And everybody that's quick with figures has already figured out that if interest rates move up 1%, it adds $28 billion to our debt. Just that little fluctuation in interest rates, because we have 70% of it financed short-term. Again, they just don't know how to manage money. Now, the money they're managing used to be your money. The debt they're building up belongs 100% to you and me. You need somebody up there who knows how to watch the cash register. The net effect of this is, through this mismanagement, is everybody west of the Mississippi's income taxes, ordinary income taxes from individuals that come into Washington, go strictly to pay interest on the national debt. I don't have to tell you that interest does not buy anything for us. Now, if you can take 4 more years of this, God bless you. I can't. Another indication is, as a result of this, the dollar continues to deteriorate, and what used to be a dollar in 1950 is now 18 cents today. As you know, it's not only how many dollars you make, it's what will a dollar buy. Well, a dollar is buying less and less and less because of the mismanagement of our country's economy. And the fact that the people in Washington, and specifically the president, don't understand business. And our problems used to be those of the Cold War. Our problem now is to rebuild our country, to reindustrialize our country, and to put our people back to work. There's only one candidate running that has done that in his business career. It's up to you. Pick the person you feel will best serve you. I bring this chart to your attention because it shows that the people in Washington, the president specifically, don't understand business. The number of manufacturing employees in our great country is now less than the number of employees, local, state, and federal, at all levels. To be a superpower, we have to make things. To be a great country, we must manufacture. The highest paid working jobs in the world are manufacturing jobs. And yet, during the past 12 years, when President Bush has been in Washington as vice president and president, and was in charge of deregulation as vice president, we've shipped whole industries overseas. One of the reasons this happens is people leave the White House staff, become federal lobbyists, have access to the White House, and have enormous influence on trade negotiations. And if you want to see something that I cannot understand at all, it's a number of very senior level people in the president's campaign staff are foreign lobbyists on leaves of absence. They're certainly not representing our interests. And I find it obscene that he tolerates it. I brought it up in the debate, and he weakly tried to defend it and then went on to another subject. But it's happening big time, and it's costing you jobs big time. The net effect of this type of hands-off, closed-eyed, hands-over-the-ears management is this right here. Our young people, 18 to 24 years old, in 1980, 18% of them made less than $12,000. Today, 40% make less than $12,000. Our country is going backward, not forward. The good jobs are no longer here. Women, 29% back in 1980, made less than $12,000. And here, 48% of the 18 to 24-year-old women in this country make less than $12,000. Now, can we afford four more years of non-leadership in terms of the most vital thing in the world to the American people, and that is the job they need to support their family? And believe me, we need your taxes from those jobs to pay our bills and run our government. And yet, his attitude is, if you don't touch it, it will fix itself. So far, it's gotten worse. If you elect me, we're going to touch it, and we're going to fix it, and we're going to rebuild the industrial base in this country, and we're going to make the words made the U.S. in the USA the world standard for excellence once again. Finally, here's the one that breaks my heart. When I was a young man, it took less than two generations to double the standard of living. There's the American dream right there. You could come from a poor family and live the American dream, go to college, be anything you wanted to be. Because of the damage I have just described here, with President and Vice President Bush in charge of the whole thing, had deregulation in the 80s. He had the wheel as captain of the ship from 88 to 92. Here's where we are today. Here is where we are today. It takes 12 generations to double our standard of living. Now, if you can live with that, if you want to just continue drifting forward, cast your vote for President Bush. If you want to fix this and get back down here where we have the American dream again, I have pledged to do that, and we'll all have to work on it, but we can do it. And when we've done it, we will feel so good about it because we did the right thing for our children. In the mid-80s, Iraq, under Saddam Hussein, gassed thousands of helpless Kurds. Our great country, the land of the free and the home of the brave, with Vice President George Bush in charge of anti-terrorism, gave full diplomatic recognition to Iraq in that same year that he gassed thousands of Kurds. Now, as president, on July the 25th, 1990, with instructions from Washington, Ambassador Glaspie told Saddam Hussein that we would not become involved with his border dispute with Kuwait. The oil wells are right there at the border. We were offended when Hussein took the whole thing. And you know the rest of the story. Our objectives in that war were to get rid of Saddam Hussein, his nuclear, chemical, and bacteriological, and give Kuwait back to their country back. At the end of the war, we returned Kuwait to the Emir, but Saddam Hussein is still in power. He still retains his nuclear, chemical, and bacteriological capability. We incurred a tremendous price under the leadership of George Bush and did not accomplish any of our primary objectives. Certainly, we cannot send American troops to fight and die so that the Emir of Kuwait can continue to live a life of royalty in an absolutely undemocratic country. We had to accomplish those other objectives also. We failed. Let's go to business now. In the 80s, Vice President George Bush was in charge of deregulation. In 1984, the President and Vice President were officially told about the savings and loan problem. They were told it was a $50 billion problem. But the PAC money kept coming in. And the biggest crooks in the world were around those savings and loans, and they were buying and paying for Washington at every level in the most flagrant way you can imagine. Whole books have been written about this. Well, the net measurement, as far as you and I are concerned, is that our government didn't even act until after the 1988 election. At that point, the problem had mushroomed to several hundred billion dollars. That's coming right out of your pocket and my pocket. You and I never got any of the benefits. But boy, do we pay the price. We have paid a high price for the 1988 elections because the savings and loans were allowed, and the banks were allowed to deteriorate for 4 years so that we could do that. Now, listen carefully to what I'm about to say. It's a matter of public record now that they're holding up bank and saving and loan failures until after this election. At least 100 banks and savings and loans will fail right after the election. Congress should have appropriated $60 billion this year, and the president should have demanded it, but everybody sat on it because it wasn't politically correct to let us know that was happening. But right after these elections, you're going to see a whole series of bank and savings and loan failures. You can read about it in the Washington Post. You can read about it anywhere you want to. It's all over the place. Nobody talks about it. I thought we ought to bring it up tonight because look at your wallet. The payment of that debt is going to come right out of your wallet, and you got none of the benefits. As president, when he was running in 1988, he said, "Watch my lips, no new taxes." In the tax and budget summit, they raised our taxes and told us if we would take that tax increase, we could balance the budget, put our house back in order, and rebuild our country for our children. They never told us. And even I didn't know that they appropriated $1.83 of new spending for every dollar they raised. In effect, they just created a massive increase in the debt. This is voodoo economics live over television. The president, in all candor, just ignored our economy as vice president and president. As president, repeatedly, he said, we were not in a recession. You knew we were in a recession. You were out of work. I knew we were in a recession. Everybody that can count knew we were in a recession. But he didn't know we were in a recession, and I don't think he knew. He was so preoccupied with diplomacy around the world and so focused on the gridlock between White House and Congress, where he got up every morning and accused Congress of everything that wasn't happening. Congress accused him. And that did not serve the American people. We cannot have gridlock. Here's a man that thinks computer chips and potato chips are the same. One of his senior economic advisors. Now, I love these economists. You know, both of them constantly quote their economists. Governor Clinton's got the Nobel Prize winning economist. George Bush has got his economist. Thinks computer chips and potato chips are the same. Had a truck driver ask me the other day, he said, "Ross, did you ever know a rich economist?" Confused me for a minute. I said, "No, I don't think I did. Why?" He says, "Well, if these old boys are so smart, why aren't they rich?" Well, folks, The economists put us in this mess we're in. Their theories got us where we are. And believe it or not, it's computer chips are the same as potato chips. If we were just planning a picnic instead of trying to plan a future for our children, chicken and potato chips might be exactly what we need. But in the serious business of our country's future and our children's future, isn't it fascinating that we have two of the three contenders who just don't have any business experience or money management experience and have a record splattered all over the place proving that they cannot deal with the issues that will determine your job, your future, and most importantly, your children's futures. So we got the chicken man and the potato chip man, and you got me. And what you need to decide as you go to vote on Tuesday is which of the three candidates has any knowledge at all. I won't say the best. Which of the candidates has some knowledge on managing money? And believe me, we've got big-time experience by Clinton and Bush in mismanaging money. Which of the candidates knows how to create jobs? There's only one that has any experience at all. Which of the candidates only belongs to the people and hasn't taken a penny from foreign interests? There's only one candidate. Which of the candidates did this just for the sole purpose of serving his country and has agreed to serve without pay as a matter of principle? Which of the candidates has said again and again and again that he will be the servant and you will be the boss? I haven't even heard that from the other two. Only one candidate understands who owns this country. You own this country. And finally, you say, you look squarely at me and say, why is he doing this? Surely all of you know now there's just one reason. I'm doing it because I love the country, I love you, and I am deeply concerned about having all of our children and grandchildren live the American dream that you and I have experienced. Potato chips and chickens are not America's future. Good night.